thank Frank and of course Emre for so kind to enlighten, to help to just ask some questions, for us to get to know you better and how you work so on and so forth. And I'd really kind of like to begin kind of as a setup, as they say, and just read a couple of things that I wrote, you know, some time ago about Emre, how we met each other. I became familiar with the work of Emre Arolat and his firm EAA in 2010 and in 2012 during the World Art Festival in Barcelona.
Okay,
in both instances, his work was shortlisted and went on to receive awards at this very prestigious event. I was impressed. I mean, I didn't know him before that, you know. I was impressed not only with the scope of the work presented, but also by the quality. I remember to this day and hold up, and I speak also as a teacher, as an example to students, in my view, the bold sensitivity demonstrated by the design for a mosque in Turkey, a truly, in my opinion, extraordinary project. And as I think Frank just mentioned, it is the mosque that has received this, this latest award. It's kind of wonderful, okay? The Sun, and I hope I can pronounce it correctly, the Sun Saklav, Sun Saklav? The Sun Saklav Mosque, which is located in Buyut, second mission. In a suburban neighborhood in the outskirts of Istanbul, in my view, it aims to address, and this is the things that then Emre wrote about his own work, which I read, the fundamental issues of designing a mosque by distancing itself from the current architectural discussions based on form and focusing solely on the essence of religious space. The interior of the mosque, a simple cave-like space, becomes a dramatic and awe-inspiring place to pray and be alone with God. The project constantly plays off the tension between man-made and natural. These are Emre's words, which I'm reading. The contrast between the natural stone stairs following the natural slope of the landscape and the thin reinforced concrete slab spanning over 6 meters to form the canopy helps enhance this dual relationship, said Ben. And then I singled out this particular project. There are many others that one could write about, large and small, in that it raises the bar for the field of architecture, which is not only a profession, but an art, which at the end of the day must elevate and ennoble the human condition. I believe strongly in that. Emre Arolat, through his work, can be classified as one of the few in his field that have raised this bar through their own professional achievements. He has, for example, demonstrated during his prolific career and through the expansion of his architectural practice, including now here we are in New York, okay, the ability to bring sensitivity and meaning to an astounding range of projects, not only in Turkey, but elsewhere. And I was particularly impressed then by Clean Kanar Marina in Turkey and the Turkish Embassy in Prague.
Significant works.
Yeah. I said Prague, okay. Both these projects, which could not be more diverse in scope and program, are a realized demonstration of the values previously mentioned. And I was thinking about, you know, I'm trying to sort of say introductory words, and please take this as, I hope, a great compliment. Your work resonates the way, for me and for many, the work of Peter Zumthor, but also Lu Kahn. Yes, and I'm saying this in all sincerity. So therefore, having said these things, I would bring the first question. In other words, this is where he's at. How did he get there? Didn't just, you know, didn't just descend, you know, the heavens make you did, I don't know. So my first kind of sort of question to you, Emre, is how did the experience of growing up in Turkey inform your sense of time? What questions does the city of Istanbul stir up in you? Can you talk to us a little bit about that?
Yeah, of course. First of all, thank you for this great introduction. Amazing. Of course, I was kind of very lucky because I was born in an architect family. Both my parents are architects. My mom is here. My dad is in Istanbul for the moment. They are my first professors. So, of course, even when I was going to into primary school, architecture was always the best actor in house. They were submitting some competitions. They were competing each other by doing some different projects for just one competition, and then arguing and let's say discussing about them. And I was like kind of referee, and I was saying my own words to the projects in the beginning, and it came something like how old were you? 15, 16, something like this. I mean, once I begin to talk about that. Before, I was loving to go to the office, to their office, to see the models, to chat with some colleagues, with some architects, some young architects. My mom always says that I was in the office since my birth, and since my 1 week old. I was always on the table. So it was a big advantage. Of course, afterwards, I would like having some other enthusiasm to be like a car driver, a rally driver. But afterwards, I mean, it was just a period. And then I went to architecture school. It's a long story, but somehow my mom didn't let me come to States to make my education in architecture, and I did it in Turkey. One day I will tell this story, maybe, but it's a very long story. We can't go to our houses. So afterwards, I mean, it was day by day I was more concerned about architecture, but I can say that I was not aware of how challenging it was. So I can say that I worked a lot. I'm still working. I'm sleeping very few, and I'm working, and I'm traveling. I don't know if I'm doing a good thing, but this is a lifestyle. I believe that architecture is a lifestyle. I'm teaching. I'm having some lectures everywhere in the world, from India to Buffalo to Rensselaer. No, I mean, you have lots of advantages since I've been coming here. So, and I learned how to speak English in the street. I didn't go to study any English school. So, it was like the beginning of my life was full of architecture, and it was a big advantage.
Kind of sort of continuing on that vein. Again, this initial question is because we want to kind of, we're having achieved, I used this mosque, but a couple of others. Now, how did you get there? So we are aware of what you've achieved, which is incredible. Therefore, so there's just a couple of kind of more questions that kind of, if I may relate to that. I mean, we are all, I think impacted upon, I certainly was, I'm sure, by the actual physical environment that we grew up in, both on a larger scale, whether it's the country, for instance, Turkey, or in more particular, your house. So can you tell us about the house you grew up in? What was it like? What was it like in terms of the environment, in terms of its location, what do you remember, what impact on it? Obviously, you grew up with two architect parents. I mean, we've spoken a little bit about that, but it's different to see them within the context of living, as opposed to the profession.
Yeah, it was an apartment, not in the center of Istanbul, but it was kind of outskirts of that time. Now it's center, beautiful ruin. But it was an apartment that, apartment building that we moved in, and the streets was not completed at that time. I mean, we were walking to the apartment because it was not possible to go there by car. It took something like some months to be able to go with the car. But it was one of the few very modernist apartments in Istanbul, designed by a really well-known and, in my opinion, talented architect. It was my first house that I liked, with a very unique panorama of Bosphorus. It was like heaven. But the apartment, architectural-wise, it was very different than the others. So I remember that I was kind of proud of living there, showing this inside the interior design and everything to my friends. They were coming and seeing like a museum, because it was very different than their house, because their house was ordinary Turkish house. And ours was not.
Which is
a bit oriental, let's say, a bit not designed. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that in a figurative way, but it was very different. And our house was like an Italian house, designed by two architects, and then all the furniture was designed by some Italians, and then, it was not, we grew up very well, but we were living in a good mood, in a good context. So it affected me. I saw yesterday I was coming from Miami, and on the plane I watched a movie of, I didn't know him, Zal.
Who was it?
And I saw his life, how he began, and I mean, it's a shame that I don't know him now. I understood that I should know him. But it reminds me lots of things from my life also. I mean, all the problems with the family, all the growing problems, and having kind of individual responsibility, quitting mom. It's just, we have lots of similarities. Okay, not much. but once again, I can say that I was as a second generation architect. In Istanbul, living in Istanbul, living in Etilay, which is the central area of Istanbul. But at that time, it was full of pine trees, and it's like a rural area. So I was very lucky.
What was that? Kind of questions, so in the same vein, in terms of your daily, your growing up experience within a physical environment. In terms of the immediacy of your home, for instance, what was going on the walls?
Some very modernist Turkish paintings, groups. I remember one of them, for example, called Kara Fatma, which is Black Fatma. It's a very famous woman soldier, a soldier of Atatürk in the independence war. And we had this big painting, which was something like 1.5 meters to 3 meters, with a very fancy wall-looking frame, a very special frame. And Kara Fatma was like with her gun, with her rifle, with some black eyes and some weird things. But it was a very very famous, it is a very famous painting for the moment. So my mom has this, still has this, and I'm trying to have it. But I remember that my cousin was coming to our house and that he couldn't look to Karafatna because she was a bit scary. But I mean, our walls was full of Turkish paintings. And they were all modern paintings with Toraderos, Cihat Kuraks, and some others. And it affected me a lot because I was painting and I was like, imitating them with some colors and some different kind of paintings, and it was a good palette and it was a good canvas for me, not only physical but intellectual as well, because we had lots of guests in the house talking about poem, talking about literature, talking about architecture, and it was a bit different.
Istanbul, great city. I've had the good fortune of being there only once, to go back. Shut up. I know a few Turkish words, so yes, be careful. Wandering around the city, as I'm sure you did, other than the perhaps the obvious, trade monuments, were what buildings at that age of 15, 16, or formative years, whatever, really kind of sort of impacted or impressed you somehow?
Yeah.
Reinforced, and maybe you begin, in contrast to your parents, who were architects and so on, maybe begin to give you even a different impression about what architecture is.
Yeah. I remember that all these era's architects were somehow friends of my parents. But I remember one of them, he's not alive for the moment, Günaycin İngiliz. He was, in my opinion, one of the best architects who ever came to the country. And the second one, Haluk Aysa. They were my favorites. And then, for example, Mr. Baysal has two residential buildings in Bebek and in Mecidiyeköy. Each was like a bit Corbusian, nothing, 100% Corbusian. But I mean, very nice and very nicely done, very nicely finished examples of this era as well. So the other thing, Mr. Çelikeroğlu, one of the buildings of him is a newspaper building, which is still in its place. Unfortunately, contaminated too much. I mean, it's a very harsh thing. Because in those days, I have to confess that we are living in a city which is a bit polarized, maybe half. Nearly half of the people doesn't care about those buildings, doesn't care about those years, doesn't care about the public, and they have kind of a revanchist feeling for them. So one of the most important buildings of this era was Atatürk Cultural Center. And somehow, its architect was a very close friend of my parents, and as well, and its new architect is a former partner in some projects, and then the art president wanted to tear down the building and do another one instead of this. But it was, in my opinion, unlogical to tear it down because it has a very large plot. It was always possible to renovate it and then make some additions, but with the same similar kind of revanchist feeling, they tear down the building now for the moment, months ago, and they are doing totally new projects instead of. And I believe that this era was very important. I believe that cities are...
And which years were they used?
It was in the 50s, in the beginning of the 50s. And I believe that cities are getting richer and richer with those different layers. I don't believe that it's Istanbul's only valuable buildings are from Ottoman. Because I mean, cities are getting old, and getting old for a city is a big advantage if it's a good way. Because I mean, you can't create the city from zero, because it's, I mean, you need some time and some layer about that. But if you
we see that happening.
Yeah. If you tear down a specific era, and if you put it away, I mean, you lose lots of things. So it's a pity that Istanbul is losing those buildings day by day, every day, and it's a process. I hope that it will finish soon, very soon.
Before now,
24th. It's my birthday, you know? But the 24th of June is my birthday, and it's the election.
Are you, so you're Gemini?
Yeah.
Me too.
No, Gemini and Cancer.
No. Well, but just to sort of kind of round out, you know, a couple of questions, your own sort of personal feelings and so on and so forth. You mentioned two of a couple of your heroes, which are contemporaries.
Yeah.
Your contemporaries, or more or less, or your parents' contemporaries, and so on and so forth. When I look, and maybe others, I mean, I'm not an architectural critic or anything like that, but when I look, let's say, at some of, let's say, most of the other projects, they are very, I don't want to use the word traditional, but there's just something, there's elements about them, you know, that somehow give them a sense of permanence, if you will. They are, to use a Greek word, diachronika, which means they pass over many periods of time. They're not identified with a period. This is
kind of timeless.
A timelessness, which is great for any of us to achieve. Therefore, do you, for sake of provoking you a little bit, are you rejecting a lot of the great works of
not at all. I mean, I'm a big fan of it. But I reject to imitate. That's my... I mean, of course, there are lots of things to learn from this tradition, including the how to have an understanding of spacing, how to construct the space, how to make spaces fluid, not always learning it from the contemporary examples, but because it comes from that era. But at the end of the day, it's kind of a habit in Turkey for the moment, in larger for the moment, to imitate those things, like caricatures, and somehow doing some kind of a very old, dated kind of American postmodernism, and naming it as Seljuki or which is makes no sense. So, for example, the new palace of
president
is they are saying that it's coming from Seljuk, but it's an 80s postmodernist American building. I don't understand anything. Except some paintings or some accessories inside. So I'm not rejecting to learn them, to learn from the tradition. Vice versa, I'm very much concerned about them, but I'm rejecting to imitate.
Could you articulate, let's say, just two things, maybe three, that one can learn from the experience, from the Ottoman or the Greek. For instance, Byzantine, you know, the great bones and so powerful structural ideas there.
Of course, I mean, spacing, I mean, for example, there are lots of books that are similar. That's an interesting one. It's a great design. But I mean, some of them are like having the same and ordinary things. But I believe that in his architecture, especially in his architecture, the continuity is very useful. And the kind of sustainability is very useful. He was, at that time, he was pretty much ahead of and creating some very innovative structures and everything. And it was like he was doing some normal things, but it was not normal for him. It's very important to read them from here, because I mean, at that time, when you compare with the other geographies, with the other countries, for example, what Sinan did was very important.
One last kind of, if you will, personal question. And I don't mean this to be sort of prodding or anything like that. What else do you do, if anything, you know, in terms of your creative slash private or personal life that somehow you feel has helped you or continues to help you in your own creative process, your own personal creative process?
I don't know. I think that it's a kind of way of thinking, maybe. And I believe that an architect should try to be intellectual and should try to learn, should try to educate her or himself with lots of different sources. And I believe that teaching is something very important, because, I mean, teaching keeps you dynamic, teaching keeps you always alert, and I feel it. I mean, whenever I teach, I'm always more dynamic than the other times. I believe that architects create in a different way, I believe that, like Rafael Moniev said very ingeniously, globes are, or places are, discrete. So in a way, you begin to hear this whisper, and you begin to learn how to hear or how to connect with this whisper. So in a way, I believe to the context, if there are very roughly two different types of doing architecture, one is contextual and one is dated. I know that it's dated in it, it's being considered dated in it, but I'm dated and I will be contextual always, because I'm very much concerned about the place and how the whispers work in place. So I believe that I'm not a believer of globalism, especially in architecture field.
You are not.
I'm not. You can ask me what are you doing here, and then. But I'm trying to learn. I mean, for example, we did a project in Manhattan, and I worked for months, let's say for days, lots of days, days and nights, to learn a bit more about Upper East. I mean, and I saw that it's a train. And whatever you discover by seeing, by talking, by reading, or by watching, keeps you very dynamic, keeps you very, I mean, it's like, it's kind of an archaeology, and I like it. I think this keeps me alive, this keeps me dynamic, and always I'm trying to find kind of a zero point of every project or every subject. I'm trying to have some. First of all, I can say that sometimes we pretend like we are corporate, even though we are not. It tempt people because of me, I guess, because I don't know how to deal with it. But second of all, I have a great team. And I can assert that I have the greatest team in the world now. But I did a lot for that team. I mean, to obtain this quality, I did a lot. And still trying to have this team even better. But, I mean, I still believe that scale is important in architecture. I mean, I'm not talking about the scale of the projects. I'm talking about the scale of the office. For example, here in New York, we have the intention, we are aiming to grow up, but not more than 20, 25 architects, for example. I know that it's a kind of guess, or it's a kind of, because somebody showed me one of my interviews 15 years ago. I told them that the ideal scale for an office of architecture should be more than 10 architects, and the bigger more than 100 after just 5 years. But now I'm saying that in New York we won't go more than 20, 25. This is my scale. And I believe that what you were describing in a very ingenious way about our buildings and about our roads should remain, should remain this quality, whatever it is. For that reason, we should continue to do our work like we were doing, even in a different country, and I believe that in this city there, it's a challenge. It's like a big forest. I think you can lose yourself very easily. But I believe that once you have this kind of batch of talents in a geography, in a context, it makes you even more dynamic. It makes you even more assertive. Makes you even more, let's say, awakening. I like it. And I like the power of this. I like New York very much. I'm living in a very high building and I'm seeing every day. I feel myself like a small city. But I mean, it gives me lots of intention. It's giving me lots of hope. Because I'm there, I don't have to do this. And for that reason, I believe that we have to keep our spirit, our kind of amateur spirit. But okay, we will grow up, and we will have some projects, of course. I believe that we will have some projects in the Western side. If we have Dr. Frank, we have some projects. And I think that it's important to have this kind of a team here. Because, as I just told you, I don't know how to delegate, but I know how to work together. I learned it in more than 30 years. I learned it, it's very important, it's very good. And I know that nearly all architects in my team thinks in a similar way about how to do architecture, which is great. Some can find it very boring, but it's because it makes you richer and richer. It makes the project better and better. It's like a tennis game, in my opinion. If you play tennis with a good tennis player, with a nice player, you even play better. So if you have a good team, if you talk with them every day with some reviews, I mean, it's a very enjoyable process. I like it. I like to create something with them, talking something to them, and having an answer or a response from them after 2 days, and then saying something which is relevant or just changing a bit. But I mean, it's a game. It's a very enjoyable game. And at the end of the day, all the buildings that we created until now, they rise to the terrain that is.
And then again, building on that statement, whatever you mentioned is, you know, about living right now, living in New York, you know, on a high building.
Yes.
And I think we're all, you know, I think one of the reasons we live and work here, yes, we all feel the dynamism of the city and are stimulated by, you know, the environment here on many, many levels. And it'd be interesting, you know, to hear how, what is it, you mentioned obviously people that you work with, that you have here, inspiring. Are there, how about the physical environment of New York City? When you look out your window, when you walk down the street, how does this impact on your architecture, and your architectural process?
Not only working and being here, even since lots of years, New York affected my feelings about my architecture as well. Because I'm always asserting that New York is a very kind of a porous city. Because, I mean, you can walk in the city, and you can go wherever you want. By walking and by passing all the buildings inside, outside. For example, I mean, people are all, we were, once I remember that we were arguing with me, the wife of my working in the dinner. She was complaining about the city, and I, okay, you have to come to Istanbul to see the Asian communities. I mean, you can't walk in Istanbul because you have only the pavements, you have some walls, you have some, let's say, military kind of communities in some. In the new rural part of Istanbul, I'm talking about the new rural part of Istanbul, and you can't walk wherever you want. In Manhattan, in this city, you can go wherever you want. For example, you can go inside of AT&T building, inside of AT&T building, and having a coffee with a loser, if you want. Okay, there is some restrictions in the elevator lobby, but you don't have to go to everywhere. I mean, you can stay somewhere. But Whenever I come to New York, I feel this kind of independence. It's a very important. There's a kind of a very similar feeling in London as well. They are local cities. They are porous. In the ground floor. Ground floor is very important because I mean, once you make a zoning in the ground floor, it's very dangerous. Zoning restrictions. This is the working area. This is the, let's say, the domestic area, or this is the immigration area. This is the old kind of urban things. I hate that. What I like more or most in New York, you can find everything in everywhere. So it's a kind of a social conglomerate, which is very grateful, which is very valuable in my opinion. And it's a very specific city in that I don't feel in the other cities in the United States.
So therefore, could you say that even in, let's say, designing a fairly complex project in New York City, that you would begin with it having, with it giving the architecture itself, giving access to different range of experiences?
Yes, that's right. This is very important. This is the point. I mean, I'm not talking about those big new projects. Like, I'm not sure about that.
I'm very sure.
Will it be a big gated community or not? We'll see. But I mean, what I like in New York, even the gated communities are kind of accessible. So this is a very important special difference.
Do you try to, I'm interested also, because of, you know, Istanbul, as we all know, is a great city that spans east and west, you know? But now, it's a bigger east and west for you. You know, it's the west being New York, and the east being the city that, you know, gave birth to me, as they say, and so on and so forth. What kind of transfers, in terms of your work, are occurring between what you just said about New York to, let's say, Istanbul, and vice versa.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Now, because there are many wonderful, I mean, allow me to say there are many wonderful things about Istanbul, surely. So, could you talk to us a little bit about this transfer of knowledge, transfer of experience, et cetera, between these two extremes?
We used to have a very well-known Turkish writer, he had a series of books. One of them was one of the names was Which East, and the other one was Which West, with questions. And I can say that, especially in this era, there is no any homogeneous West and there is no any homogeneous East, but still there are some special things. So I believe that West, I mean the pragmatist, structuralist West, has a lot to learn from kind of existentialist East, and of course East is always learning from West in a technical or in some kind of innovative way. And I like this transition, I value this transition. So in a way, I feel very comfortable when I see some Eastern habits when I'm living in New York. And I feel very happy when I see some New Yorker things in Istanbul. I'm not that conservative to conserve the cities like as they are. I don't believe it. Because, of course, I don't believe to different and shallow kind of globalism, but of course cities and regions should learn from each other. And this transition is very unpredictable. I mean, it should become like this. I mean, for example, who can say that New York is not a traditional city? Because I mean, once I came to New York in the beginning of the 80s, people told me that New York is not a traditional city, there's no tradition in New York, buildings are very new, everything is very new. And we were proud of having Istanbul as an ancient city. Once, I mean, when you go to Istanbul now and when you compare New York, for example, we don't conserve anything in Istanbul. And you conserve lots of things. I know that you're tearing down some of the buildings as well, like your museum in front of MoMA, which is great in my opinion. But I mean, in a way, it's a kind of a destiny of the cities. And I think that there are lots of transitions between East and West, especially in this era. And we have to not stop in this, not try to stop this. We have to use it in a good way.
Yeah. You're also a teacher, like myself, I think you said that your teaching also informs your work and so on. Related to what you said, because I think a lot of students today are battling not only with pencil versus paper, but also with the notion of identity.
Yeah.
Their own identity, you know, as creative beings, okay? And then how that identity, once established, is applied. Can you talk to us a little bit about how what you just spoken about, these experiences of Europe and so forth, how that also informs your teaching and perhaps your future co-workers?
Yeah. Of course, I mean, let's begin with the teaching. I mean, I taught in Turkey, in some different cities in Turkey. I began to teach because of my mom, or maybe with the help of my mom, because once I heard somebody was calling her to teach in Bursa, which is a very near city to Istanbul, and she was very busy at that time, and I was in front of her, I said, I can't, I can't. very young. And then she told to the dean of the school, you know, I have a son, he's talented, he can come to your school. And I went there like this in 1996, something like this. I was quite young. But I mean, it was a nice experience. And afterwards I taught in some very different schools in Turkey, even in Europe, in Delft, in Berlage, and in Yale. I know that, I believe that identity is something very serious to take into consideration. And of course, not in a very, let's say, I don't know how to say, too much conservative way, but I mean, understanding about the hallmarks of the different identities is one of the most important aspects of research. So, in order to keep those identities, or to reach those identities, you have to understand in a deep way. So I always, when I teach, I always learn from my students. For example, last semester I was in Yale, and I was the weakest person in English. They were all very fluent. And I learned a lot about the United States, about Islam. And I mean,
the current architectural jargon,
of course,
which is dangerous.
Yeah, it's dangerous. I keep myself a bit away from it. I can't learn it. Maybe my body is not refusing it. But in a way, I feel that. Yeah, identity is a very serious aspect. It's a very serious subject to ours, but we should be careful.
And just since we just introduced a little bit of teaching, I imagine, like many of us, that we've kind of alluded to that, or I would like to believe, you know, that your teaching is kind of interwoven. Therefore, well, which is not always the case, but I think it's very, very important. keeping that in mind, looking and thinking about your own future, how concerned are you about the future of your students, and I'm assuming you are, and in what areas are your concerns?
Yeah, I mean, we talked about the dominance of digital world, which is a kind of inevitable phenomenon, which I should accept this, not to fight with it. But I believe that, I mean, I have a fear that the world will finish.
Seventy waiting person like this.
And then
he was a really gentle thief. he opened our doors. And then we could able to work after 10 days. Because it takes too long to have all those doors. So, this changed my mind a bit. I said, okay, why don't we go back to the but this is a reality. And then I think that we asked to this gentleman who is doing our new servers and everything now, because before the IT firm that we were working with said that we are one of the most secure firms in the world. But afterwards, we found somebody. He came to the office, and then with a very dated laptop. And then it took only 2.5 minutes for him to go into our mails, even for the finance. It's crazy. And he said, "I asked him, can you do it in a bank?" He said, if I will have enough time, I said, how many times? If I can stay 4 days in the karate bank, I can do it. Can you imagine this? I mean, I believe that.
So did you tell your students about this?
No. No, because it's very new. But it's incredible, but it's true. And I believe that this will cause a big problem to future students, yeah, future students.
In other words, the unleashing of technology, which is supposed to help us, but in fact,
yeah,
would be.
And I believe that, in the old days, there will be a kind of a very small society who will lead this, and we all will follow, like the oligarchy or like the. So I think it's a kind of a digital political oligarchy that we will obey them and they will follow. Because it's a big show at the same time. But I mean, I don't know how people are aware of it, but I believe that it will be in the very near future. So in that case, okay, of course, once again, push back or go back to the essence of architecture. What is architecture? What are we doing for? I mean, what is the essence of the building? What is the essence of the place? I'm much more interested with steel as an old-fashioned. But of course, in the new future, I believe that there will be something that will all be surprised, and it will be a big disaster. And it will come with the digital.
So that's kind of a little bit pessimistic.
Maybe not. Maybe we will get rid of everything, and then it will be a new kind of social democracy. I don't know.
But one comes in because some time for some questions from the guests here, which would be great, but just a couple more things, if I may, okay? One kind of relating extension, which relates, again, in terms of your feelings, what interests you and so on. You mentioned that, and which I think is terrific, that you are many role model, and it's great to hear and be heard. Can you identify for us, I will use the term architectural moments, asking for a specific architect or whatever, architectural moments that can serve, or have served, or can serve as role models, if you will, for not only for yourself, but also for your students?
Architectural moments, yes. I mean, trips are very interesting and very valuable architectural moments. Trips to some different countries, some discovery trips. I believe that going out of the normal life.
daily habits and everything. And seeing some new things is a very valuable thing. And those are the real architectural moments. Because I mean, in this table or in the other table, you're always in the same position, dealing with lots of problems and everything. And it's not very easy to discover things. Of course, you have internet and everything, but I mean, seeing even a gray storm for the first time in the shore of Sindh, for example, can serve you to understand why those buildings are like this. Or talking with an old guy who is in the protection committee of the island can teach you lots of things. So you can't do it in your table. In my opinion, architectural moments are much more outside of the normal daily life. Because I mean, yes, we are, once we go to our houses, we watch TV, we see some movies, we do some research on the internet, and then we read lots of books, but this is not the same. Mm-hmm. Seeing and observing in a good way, in a good manner, is very important. For me, they are the real architectural moments.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, that's great. I mean, if I may just share just one line of history, is taking the ferry, not the tourist ferry, the normal ferry, from the west to the east, and looking back, on the mosques and all. I mean, that was, and you draw it and so on. That was an incredible moment for me.
You understood the city, right?
I tried to understand, but it also stimulated me. It taught me to this day. Like, those images are in my mind. So, therefore, could, and I don't mean to put words in your mouth, but are you saying that maybe too many of our students today, or even maybe ourselves, because of the accessibility we have, digitally to the world, and we talk about virtual, that there is less of an incentive to have these kind of real architectural moments that might inform our architecture?
There's a term in we use it in the internet world, it's surfing. Surfing is a very surface. You're on the surface, you're not going deeper. So in the real world, it's not very easy to go deeper. I know that students are not reading too much, even in Yale, even Harvard, they are surfing, they know how to surf. They are very master of surfing. And they can reach to everything in 5 seconds. So for that reason, they don't value that too much. I mean, I remember myself at the university to try to discover Mr. Kahn's buildings, going to the library, sitting there for 10 hours, drawing those plans once more, and then trying to understand about the relationship between the walls and the space, and the trying to understand the difference between Theoharis plaques, let's say, or the planes, and Kahn's walls. So it was a deep thing for me, big fight for me, and I think I really enjoyed it. Now I can't imagine a single student doing this. This would be very boring or very, very weird. we have a saying in Turkish, we call deer, geek. It's a geek. There are some Turkish people here. It's doing geek. Trying to understand the difference between two Kahn's.
Through the work of your, through, along with your colleagues. So, any questions, please, for him, or comments? Not for me.
I'd be so bold to ask the first one.
Introducer.
So this whole, like, I never heard this before from you, but this whole, like, your daughter and the EAA students are almost operating on this meta plane where they're not, like, meta knowledge, where they're not really digesting the original works, so they're digesting the, like, Cliff's notes or the, you know, book for dummies of all the knowledge, and maybe that's a trend in society, right?
Yeah.
Right now, do you think?
Yeah.
Where does that go? Can you talk about that?
As well as I understood from your tour videos. I understood everything that he said. But it's not very easy for me to understand. Because, I mean, we were together in a car for 2 days. Talking, of course, for me to listening. I understood half of it. I always tell him, please, quiet, please be slow. I don't understand what you're saying. He's like talking with a, you know, like, okay, as well as I understood from you, Frank, my dear Frank. Yes, you're right. It's like it's another game that I don't know how to play very well. But I'm not saying that it's a wrong thing. It's a wrong road. It's just it's different, and we have to understand the difference of it, and we have to value. We had a very big discussion with a friend in my age, because he was criticizing this new approach of being not very deep, but having this surfing thing. And I said, okay, don't criticize it. Just try to understand it. Because, I mean, you're not in the same world. The world is changing. And maybe in 3 decades or in 3 generations, the books will not be like that. The vision will be finished and will be completely something else. I said this in Turkey in a lecture, for example. I said that television is dying. People didn't understand this. Only it's a very new thing by its time, because it's time, because you can't watch whatever you want, whenever you want. Because television has a program. If you have something programmed, it's not good for the new generation. The new generation, in my opinion, doesn't like programs. They want to create their own programs, and they want to follow these individual programs. So in a way, it's another game. We have to understand this, but I believe that this is the new world. And, for example, here in New York, sometimes I'm trying to write something for a new project, and you are always stopping me to this, because I write a lot, and you say nobody reads, and Özge is stopping me. Don't do it, because I mean, people, I mean, you have to write in 4 sentences, and I can't do this. I just make an introduction in 4 sentences. But it's a new
agree.
We have to understand this.
Any other questions?
Well, I just want to say that I'm so grateful to hear, you know, one of the luminaries of our time, you're talking in these terms that, you know, thank goodness you want to write, so please do write, because this is what we all need to read, you know, because it's important to hear this stuff. But I also appreciate that you're being dismissive of technology, but helping us to kind of reframe that, because, you know, we can't deny it, but it's an important way of trying to kind of bring it all together, and hopefully you're teaching that that was something that kind of can somehow permeate through, so maybe one or two.
I want to ask you, so you're traveling, you're working with different clients from different countries, and with the experience, different cultures. I'm wondering, as a Turkish background, a Turkish architect, what differences do you find in terms of perceptual perspective of architecture. Like, when you go to Turkey, when you work with a Turkish client, when you come to Miami, you work with an American client, what differences do you see? What's the understanding of architecture?
There's no any difference. I can say. Yes. Yesterday, we did the presentation, and the first comment was, how can we reduce the price? I mean, this is,
human.
this is a very common thing. I mean, so, are they American? I don't know. They're from Venezuela. I don't know. I don't know what the meaning of American. All of our origins is coming from somewhere else, in my opinion. We are all humans. And then I think that this flattening, this transition between the cultures affect the clients as well. So in a way, we have some clients in Turkey which are very sophisticated and which are having some very, let's say, high-end expectations. And we have some clients in the United States which are not like this. And we have the vice versa. So in a way, I don't believe that this Turkish jargon, let's say, saying that, okay, that we have to educate the client in Turkey. This is totally wrong. You have to educate yourself as an architect to understand. But there is a very stupid belief in Turkish architecture world that the clients are not understanding architecture, they are not familiar with architecture, they should not. If not, they shouldn't come to you. I mean, okay, but they have some knowledge about what they are willing to have. So in a way, I don't believe that there is a big difference between those cultures in that manner. Of course, there are lots of specificities, there are lots of differentiations, but it depends on the geography. Not to be nationalities. But the geographies form our characters more than the nationalities, especially in this era. Okay, we're talking about hundreds. Hundreds years ago, nationalities were very important. But now it's because, but the geography makes the difference, which is important. Which is important to understand and to consider.
So we've been talking a lot about sort of the digital aspect of architecture and conflict or use of it. And you said earlier you were talking about listening to buildings. So I'm wondering, in the context of like listening to buildings and sort of also understanding the place that you're in, sketching still part of that process for you?
I don't think so. Once again, I can say that there are, in that way, there are two kinds of variables, two kinds of the first phase of architecture, let's say, from the project. One common thing is doing some sketches with computer or computer hand, and trying to get an idea or try to come to somewhere by drawing. And most of the architectural echoes or schools are doing this. And they believe to do this. Personally, I don't believe this. Because I think that it's a kind of a contamination. It will contaminate your brain, your
pollute,
which is very important, because I believe more than this, I believe to think about that, to analyze, to understand, to internalize, to find some distinctions, and afterwards to come to a point, and afterwards to make it real by drawing, by sketching. But I know in my school, in the University in Turkey, all the professors will ask him, where is your alternative? That's the worst question that you can ask for a student. It means that, are you stupid? You can't hear, you can't understand, because you should have some alternative.